weeks in a row. Good morning. Welcome to Brookdale this beautiful, beautiful May morning. We're glad to have you here. Delighted as we gather together, I'm going to invite you to sing on our first song, The Solid Rock. It's in our hymnals 404. It will also be on the screen. We're going to sing all four verses. I'll invite you to stand on that last verse.
Morning. Today's scripture reading will be from Psalm 47. Clap your hands, all peoples. Shout to God with loud songs of joy. For the Lord, the Most High, is to be feared, a great king over all the earth. He subdued peoples under us and nations under our feet. He chose our heritage for us, the pride of Jacob, whom he loves, Selah. God has gone up with a shout, the Lord with the sound of a trumpet. Sing praises to God, sing praises. Sing praises to our King, sing praises. For God is the King of all the earth, sing praises with a psalm. God reigns over all the nations. God sits on his holy throne. The princes of the people gather as the people of the God of Abraham. For the shields of the earth belong to God. He is highly exalted. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning with thanksgiving in our hearts, for you are the King and reign over all the earth. You alone are worthy of our praise. As we gather now to worship you, we ask for your grace to tune our hearts to you so that our worship and praise will be honoring and pleasing to you this morning. May you be glorified. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Again, we welcome you this morning. Please remain standing as we sing the song, I Love to Tell a Story, an old hymn. Father's love for us. I'm going to give a short book report. We've been in a Bible study, about a dozen men, and I grew up with a harsh, judgmental father, I guess, punishment type versus love. And we've been learning about the first reaction of God is love, not judgment. And it's a hard concept after 60 years to teach an old dog a new trick. But this song is a good reminder of that. So please join us in how deep the Father's love for us. Time, as you know, May is our missionary month. We have two videos we'd like to show this morning. Thank you.
We're going to be singing the song, Just As I Am. The verses are the same as the familiar hymn, but we'll be singing a new chorus along with it. So please stand and sing that with us. Just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst me come to thee, O Lamb of God, I come, I come. Just as I am and waiting not to rid my soul of one dark blood, to thee whose blood can cleanse each spot, O Lamb of God, I come, I come. Come broken to be mended, I come wounded to be healed, I come desperate to be rescued, I come empty to be filled.
Be seated. If you're wondering where Pastor Overmiller is, he is in Wadena, Minnesota, Lake Country. And this is the second time we've done a church swap, or pastor swap, so to speak. First time was with Joe DeVitro a number of weeks ago. And now Pastor Jake Heppner from the church in Wadena is here to join us. And if you haven't gotten a chance to meet or talk with Pastor Heppner, I encourage you to do so. He's a great guy. Great guy to get to know. He loves his family. He has five kids. And he's been, I didn't ask how long you've been married.
Yeah.
That's probably
25 years.
So it's great to have him here. He does like fishing. So I think you have a number of things in common with some people here. And he was telling me he caught one this big, maybe not that big, but Pastor, come and encourage us with the word, and thank you for your ministry.
Thank you, Casey.
You said that I had things in common with people who are here with fishing, but this is fishing opener, so maybe I have more in common with the people who aren't here this morning. I've been with Dina 15 years, and that is the church that Chip Tranby grew up in. He was gone for a long time before I got there, so I'm not responsible for any of that. You can't pin any of that on us. We came from the Brainerd Church, and I just love the association that we have. We have about 30 regular Baptist churches, and I love being able to be a part of the network that's there, the love, the support, doing things with each other. I know a lot of your guys from the men's retreat that we have in February, and so when I walked in, I saw a lot of familiar faces, people I've talked with before, and gotten to know personally and played basketball with and had late night talks with. So thanks for having us here today. I hope Pastor Overmiller is doing well at our church. I just got a frenzied texts here as we were singing about the PowerPoint issues going on there. So hopefully they can get some of that taken care of. When we came to Wadena about 15 years ago, my youngest teenager had just been born. And that was really exciting to be able to have that. Our kids, I think we're the only kids in the church. There was a group of older people who really loved us and took care of us. They were really good people. And I had a hard time calling myself their shepherd because they had been saved for more years than I've been alive. And just to hear them pray, to hear them talk about the relationship with the Lord was a real example and model for me. We prayed a long time for other young families and for kids. And of course, if you're an older congregation, young families is like what you're thirsty for. And when we would have young families visit our church and walk in the door, I know Frank and Lila would be right there ready and waiting, making sure that this young family would know that this could be their home. They'd be loved, appreciated, and really cared for. And that really won the day for us on many occasions. I wish that some of these people who have prayed for us over the last 15 years could see some of the ministries at our church now. We've been doing teens and Wednesday night groups for about 8 or 10 years now, but we started a new class for kindergarten and under just because we had all these kids that were coming, and we had this little tiny classroom, hardly bigger than your grand piano, maybe three of those, and we had 15 kids in there last Wednesday night. So we need some educational room in that way, but it's just really exciting to be a part of this and be able to see how people grow, how churches change and move along. Our church is mostly people younger than me now, first-generation Christians, and some have bunches of kids, but it's just really interesting to see people saved and then baptized and then become parents and see the way the Lord works through them, and some were deacons, and it's just really great to be a huge part of His plan that way. And I was so glad that your church was able to call Thomas Overmiller last year, 2 years ago. In my mind, in our association, the Moorhead Church and the Rochester Church are kind of flagship operations of our regular Baptist ministries. And I know a little bit about Thomas Overmiller, and I was really thankful that a person with his capacity was able to come here. I just think he's such a perfect fit, him and his family. So I'm really excited to see what the Lord is going to continue to do here. And I appreciate being able to be a small part of this here this Sunday. We're going to be in Psalm 19 this morning. Psalm 19. It would be most helpful if you could be there in a physical copy of your Bible this morning, because I want some help from you this morning. Pastor Overmiller said he was going to leave his son Josh in the front row, but I see that he left. He said that if any hint of heresy was heard, that Josh was going to rush the stage. So I had to be extra careful on what I was going to say today. So maybe he went to go help with children's church, and that gives me a little leash. Psalm 19, I've got three aims for you this morning. The first is to elevate the magnificence of your salvation as God's preeminent miracle. The second is to simply counter the loud secular voices that are in opposition to your belief and worldview that you see throughout the week. They aren't always deep, but I know that they're loud. So I just want to be able to spend some time from God's word countering that outside pressure and the volume that you feel there. And thirdly, I just want to direct your attention to respond to God's direction in your heart and faithfulness this morning. So you're there in Psalm 19. I want to take just a couple of moments here, and I want you to read that, and I want you to ask yourself, if I had to give this for a devotional tonight, if I had to come back tonight and they said, would you present a devotional in Psalm 19, where would I make the divisions of interpretation? If I were to look at this and say, what are the divisions in Psalm 19, and what are the topics that are addressed there? So I know you can't do that very well in 2 or 3 minutes, but just take 3 minutes here, read through that, and ask yourselves, where would I make the divisions, and what would the main points be? One more minute. All right, what'd you come up with? My Bible has some cheats in it. It gives me some separation between a couple of these themes, these topics here. You probably don't normally talk back. Our church is really small, so we all talk back. Sometimes they talk back too much. Where would the first division be? Verse 1 through 6. And what would the topic be? If you had to give a devotional on this, what would you say is the theme of those verses? What makes that separate from the rest of the passage? The witness of creation. Love it. How about the second division? Where would you make that next division? 7 through 11, what would you call that? Wisdom of God. Someone said the giving of the law. Okay. Anyone else? It's the word of God. And then it looks like you left a couple of verses on the end there to tail along. What would you call those? Someone said, I can't see with all these bright lights in my face. It's a lot more individual. Now it's to a person. It gets real personal in application that way. So the first 6 verses, to the choir master, Psalm of David, the heavens declare the glory of God, and the sky above proclaims his handiwork. Day into day pours out speech, and night to night reveals knowledge. There is no speech, nor are there words whose voice is not heard. Their voice goes out through all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. In them he has set a tent for the sun, which comes out like a bridegroom leaving his chamber, and like a strong man runs his course with joy. Its rising is from the end of the heavens and its circuit to the end of them. And there's nothing hidden from its heat. That's the first division there. And Psalm 19 kind of works like a funnel. We call this general revelation or witness to God through the miracle of creation. And this is generally observable to everyone. And we call that general and revelation because, number one, it's something that is general about God. It tells us some things about his character from what we can see in creation. And secondly, it's available to everyone. Everyone all over the face of the earth can see the things that the psalmist writes about here in Psalm 6. So in Psalm 6, we read those first six verses. We call that general revelation, things we can see about God from his creation. What types of things can we know about God from the witness of his creation? What types of things do people understand about God when they look out and they see the things that he's made? Go ahead and holler some of those out. His omnipotence, his power, perfections, a sunrise is beautiful. There's something about a sunrise that just really resonates with us. And every day we get one. We can't always see the sun because of the clouds, but every day we get that. So my wife is taken to the way our house is. We can open up the blinds and the sun just beams right into our living room. But in the winter times, she has to move her chair over quite a bit in order to get there. And she reads her Bible and prays in the sunbeam in our living room. And there's just something special about a sunrise. And it's not sun worship, but it reveals, it aligns, and it's like a parallel voice with God's word that illustrates how beautiful, how magnificent, how all-powerful he is. Isn't that neat? We would say creation is one of God's preeminent miracles. We've been talking about some of the Old Testament heroes at our church, and so we asked the question, are miracles valid? Do people still believe in miracles when they look at the Bible and they look at some of those Old Testament things? Even in Christianity, you have people who scoff at the idea of miracles and they try to naturalize everything. One of our church ladies was sharing the gospel with her neighbor who goes to a church, and she said, you can't really believe in all those miracles in the Bible. And we would look at things like creation, of course, as we've seen here in the first six verses, the Red Sea crossing, like I taught in my kids' Sunday school class a couple weeks ago, Jonah and the big fish, heroic accounts. At our church, we are going through David's lifetime. You look at things like David and Goliath and other heroic accounts. And, of course, one of the greatest miracles, the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Are miracles valid? When we look at this general revelation, the very first thing we see is creation, the first six verses. And when I read those six verses, I'm reminded of the passage that's a parallel New Testament passage in Romans chapter 1 that says, for the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all godliness and unrighteousness of men who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth. For what can be known about God is plain to them because God has shown it to them. We can look around at creation and see plenty that verify the existence of God and many of his communicable characteristics. So in the first six verses of Psalm 19, we start off with general revelation, and then it funnels down to what we call special revelation, and it's how God reveals himself specifically through his word. We'll look at that a little bit later on. But then at the very end, it continues to narrow down to personal application. Who can discern his errors? This is not talking about God's errors. It's talking about our own heart. Declare me innocent from hidden faults. Keep back your servant also from presumptuous sins. Let them not have dominion over me. Then I shall be blameless and innocent of great transgression. There's a lot of moral language contained in these last verses. And I would submit to you that when people reject God, when they reject miracles, when they reject creation, when they reject the resurrection, it's not because it's
too much for a mind to ask, to believe. It's not that there's no evidence. It's not that it doesn't connect or jive with what we see in the world. It's because they reject the morality of Almighty God. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. I would say there's a lot to understand and know about God from creation. There is much evidence of the plan of salvation, redemption, Jesus Christ dying on the cross and being raised from the dead for our sins. And when people follow those steps of faith, they believe in the God that they can see and understand. They believe in his words written in his word. And then they put their faith in him. They understand that God remains alive and his word remains alive and active inside of us, the greatest witness. We can be redeemed. We can connect with the God. He reveals sin to us and gives us victory over those things. But when the world rejects him, it's not because they look at creation and say, there can't be someone behind that. It's because they understand to believe in God is believing in a moral lawgiver. And it's the morality that they reject. Those last verses are where the agnostic and the atheist balk first. At the message of the Bible that mankind is separate from God because of their sin condition, that the state of being sinners in actuality of sinful actions, thoughts, and deeds, and inner impurity are what separate us from God. That God sent a Redeemer, Jesus Christ, who represents all of humanity to God through his perfect life and substitutionary death on the cross and victorious resurrection from the dead. That each human being is responsible to turn from their sin and turn to the Savior through simple faith and belief that Jesus is God and Savior, died on the cross for their sins and was raised from the dead. And after that, that each follower of Jesus is set free from the hold of sin and enabled to live a life free from sin's bondage through the power of the Holy Spirit. You know what the Bible says? The Bible says that people love darkness more than light. So many prefer to remain in the shadow of their own sin, something they're comfortable with, something they like. They resist the language of what we see here, transgression and iniquity and error and fault. And they say, that's being judgmental. I need to be true to myself. Let me be who I am. The miracle first rejected is the greatest miracle, the resurrection of Jesus Christ and redemption for sin. Creation may seem like a bigger miracle than redemption, but consider this. All that we see here, the Bible says God spoke into existence. He just breathed it out. And he made the earth. He made the gorgeous moon that you're going to see tonight, that big old blood moon as it hangs on the horizon, all the stars up there, the birds that are migrating back up, the fish in our lakes, the wind, the rain, everything that we see, he was able to breathe into existence. But when I was born, you were born, we took our first steps into a sinful world with sinful actions. There is nothing God was able to do to remove that through the voice of his mouth. There had to be strong action taken. He had to send his own son to die on the cross for our sins. He's able to speak everything that we see into existence, but when I sin and you sin, he couldn't just say, he couldn't pronounce righteousness. He couldn't just pretend like it didn't happen. couldn't just pat you on the back and say, it's all right, it's okay. The penalty of death had to be executed. So he sent Jesus Christ, his own son, to die on the cross in your place and in my place and raise him from the dead. That is a powerful miracle. Sending the Holy Spirit into my heart, that is a powerful miracle. To redirect each one of us and transform sinful people into saints is a powerful miracle. And that is the miracle that is first rejected. But when people reject God, I'm going to speak this at camp later on. This summer is kind of an apologetic side here. When people reject God, they reject Jesus Christ, they talk about things, and we live in a world with a really secular worldview. And like I said, it's very loud. When people reject God, they've only done half the job. We're going through a Bible study at a church from Max Anders, and I was on his website, and he has this blog or article, 5 Miracles That Science Wants for Free. When you reject God, you think, I'm off the hook, morally. But all the stuff that we see out here, the things that Psalm 19, 1 through 6 said that God spoke into existence, now you have to find a different solution for how all this got here. Where did it come from then, if not God? So here are some things that science has to say. We need a little help here. 5 miracles fundamental to existence that modern science is powerless to explain without God. And the first one is that something came from nothing. You realize this violates all the laws of science, that something came from nothing. It's a fundamental tenet of reason that something cannot come from nothing. Physicist Stephen Hawking said shortly before he died that he could see how the laws of physics could produce the Big Bang. But that doesn't work. If there is nothing, there is no law of physics. A few years ago, Fox TV station rebooted Cosmos, and I wanted to watch that and see what that was about. And Neil deGrasse Tyson, the world's most magnetic astrophysicist, was the host of the show. And in the very first episode, in the first couple of minutes, they have him on the backdrop of this magnificent graphics design, and there's this molten core that is supposed to explode into everything in the universe, and there's all these comets and planets flying around and everything. He makes this statement. He said, here's what we're going to do. We're going to go back as far as we can see. And there's pause, and there's that core of material that contains all the matter in our known universe. And I thought, wait a second. How does the world's smartest astrophysicist get a pass on second number one? With a ball of mass, with everything in the known universe smashed into it. I don't know how that happens. They don't know how that got there. Also, you really don't know how much matter you're talking about. They said you can compact all the matter spatially. It can work where you can compact it down to a very small size. But we don't know how big the universe is. What if what we can see is only 1% of what's out there? What if it's infinite? I'm just saying we don't really know how much matter we're working with, how much we're talking about here. So we have to come up with something to explain how something came from nothing. There's only 3 real options. Number one is you have to say the universe is eternal. It's just always been there. Number two, you have to say something came from nothing. Or number 3, God created it. The second miracle you have to try to explain is how order came from chaos. This refers to the law of entropy, second law of thermodynamics, how it's recognized that things are winding down, just given to itself, things decay. They corrupt. They don't get better, which would be the opposite of the evolutionary thinking. I grew up in Nebraska, and when I was a kid, we had this apple tree, and it produced apples about that big. And in Nebraska, anything goes for fireworks practically. So we would take inch-and-a-half firecrackers or big firecrackers, and we'd take these apples and shove a firecracker in there, and then we'd throw them at each other, and that would be like miniature grenades. And when you threw them at each other, and you light that fuse and land, you turn your face or run away or whatever, when that exploded, you didn't come up with thousands of little apples. You came up with chaos. You came up with spray. And if there's a bang, things quickly deteriorate. That spray, you couldn't just compact that and wipe that off yourself and mold that, and that would become an apple, because instead those pieces don't form back together. They rot. They corrupt. We understand order does not lead itself naturally from chaos. If there's an explosion, disorder comes from that. Deterioration is the rule. The third miracle that would have to try to be explained is how life came from non-life. This is a really fundamental law of science, law of biogenesis. Maybe you remember from your high school math or science class, Louis Pasteur was the scientist who would take meat and he'd put it into jars and he'd cover the tops of some jars with cheesecloth and the others he'd just leave out, because the idea, the thought was that maggots spontaneously arose from rotting meat. So the understanding was that life could come from non-life, but when Pasteur put the cheesecloth over some of those jars, they noticed that no maggots grew in those jars. And so he's the father of observing the law that life does not come from non-life. Life never generates from non-life. Charles Darwin wrote his work 10 years before Louis Pasteur made this observation. And you have to wonder, because Charles Darwin's work is based on the fact, the assumption that life can come from non-life. And that's how it's easier for people to grasp that, the bacteria arose from goo or nothing, and that things got better and better, and that things could evolve more, because the assumption was that you could spontaneously generate life from non-life. But when Louis Pasteur made his observation just 10 years after that, you have to wonder, how would have Darwin's work been received in light of Pasteur's scientific experiments? Darwin also was operating under the assumption that the cell, the human cell, was the most basic unit of life, and the microscopes they had then couldn't see any further into a cell. They just thought a cell was a blob of gelatin, just a gooey mass, instead of a dozen little factories all working hard through DNA that contained encyclopedias worth of information that signify order and knowledge and design. Fourth miracle that science has to explain somehow, or they have to ask for, is how does consciousness come from life, base life? So they would say, bacteria were the first things to evolve. We give higher value to some life forms than other life forms, don't we? And it's based on consciousness. You have a dog in your home, or a cat, maybe. We have several, as few as possible. Fortunately, the numbers are dwindling. But we understand you don't beat your dog. You're nice to animals. You don't needlessly grab its ears and wring them around or whatever. We'd say, well, that's bad to do to animals. And yet you don't think anything of it when you take your fly swatter and you swat the fly or the mosquito or the Asian beetle on the wall. Some people may be out fishing this weekend. We don't think anything at all. It's setting the hook and taking that fish home, flinging it, and eating it. We'd say it has limited awareness, consciousness. So we understand there are different levels of consciousness. Where did this come from? It's not something that generates. If the first life was bacteria, and then you have these little one-cell things swimming around in goo, and then they gain some more cells and get a little bit bigger, and then those develop into little tadpole-looking things, and then you have amphibians, and you have land creatures, and you have all these things, but there's a lot of difference in consciousness. And yet that isn't something that it makes sense would develop or evolve. And lastly, how does transcendence come from consciousness? So you have these land animals that have a lot of consciousness and social rules and colonies and everything, dogs, horses, monkeys, farm animals, whatever. But then how do you get something human out of that? Someone who can observe scientific laws, someone who has a morality, someone who can make civilization. There's a lot more to it than simply IQ. You realize that when you go to the zoo. These animals don't have transcendence. We are certainly distinct and separate from the animal kingdom. So atheists would say, if you give us these five miracles, we can explain the rest. How something came from nothing, how order came from chaos, how life came from non-life, how consciousness came from non-consciousness, how transcendence then came from consciousness. And then you look at some of the metaphysical questions of life that modern science has no answers for. What is the purpose of life? What is right and wrong? Who gets to decide that? How do you determine the rules for that? You take a vote? We hear that every society gets to have its own rules. Well, who is one society to tell another society what they're doing is wrong? So you have a lot of things here that are covered in the first six verses that have to be attributed to God. And when you think about it, if you want to say there is no God, it's probably not because it's too far-fetched to realize there's a being that is a prime mover that is setting everything into effect. It more must be along the lines that people don't want to hear the morality from this being. And here we move to the second section of the psalm, and this is special revelation. This is what God says he is like. The things that he values, the things that he expects from his people. The law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The rules of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, even much fine gold, sweeter also than honey and drippings of the honeycomb. Moreover, by them is your servant warned. In keeping them, there is great reward. A rejection of a creator God from the first six verses is a rejection of a moral lawgiver. I've had the privilege of being in a church with many godly people in the past. People who came to the end of their days under my ministry, and it was a privilege to celebrate their life at the end of their days. People who lived these verses, who hung their hat on the accuracy and value of the Word of God, who found it to be pure, who stood on the rock and found it to be sure. When they came to the end of their days, I looked at those days and I thought, what a good life. What a good life. To celebrate someone who invested the Word of God into their hearts, into their lives, and found it to be perfect, found their soul to be revived, found God's Word to be sure. I think of the morality of our culture in the time that I've been alive, and I've seen change after change after change after change. It is the Word of God that is sure. It's enough to make wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. I can think of people that have changed their convictions without the Word of God, changed their life, the things that they thought were right and wrong. But God's Word never changes. And I've never known a person to have to have been embarrassed about the Word of God, because it's always been true and it's always been right. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. One of the values of church, I believe, of listening to Christian music, of submitting yourself under the preaching of God's Word, both here at church and radio preachers throughout the week, and of doing Bible studies and of having a Christian network of friends, is that we have this filter in our mind and our heart, and it's just got to be rinsed out from all the secular pressure that we face. If you work at a secular place, you hear language, you see lifestyles, you listen to music, you watch TV shows of practically any kind, and we just have to understand it is what it is when you live in Babylon. But how refreshing to remember what purity is. To have your mind rinsed out of all those types of things, to backwash that filter, to remember purity. Purity is something that is so unique to the Word of God. You don't find things like purity anywhere else in our culture. Depravity is celebrated and promoted. And it's so refreshing to wake up in the morning, to open up the Word of God, to remember the voice, to have the Holy Spirit again, refresh our mind and our soul to bring revival, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The rules of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. I just look at these things and they're so countercultural to where we're at right now as people celebrate many truths. They celebrate relevance of truth. They celebrate depravity. They celebrate impurity. Those are the things that are promoted, and we have to live here. We just live in this world. We do. We're not of it, but we're here. And God's specific revelation revives our soul. Stay in it. Rejection of a creator God is a rejection of a moral lawgiver. And I think you can see rejection of the moral lawgiver results in moral chaos. Sometimes I get discouraged looking around at people I have admired or read their books or looked at their ministries as an example, and they've fallen off the pedestal morally that I've put them on. They've changed their minds and recanted their faith, some of them. Some of the people that I admire from a secular perspective, but they don't have the same moral underpinnings because they don't have the Word of God as the basis of their life. And it's so evident to see the moral chaos that is prevalent. But you have an underpinning. Verse 12, 13, 14, who can discern his errors? Declare me innocent from hidden faults. What that is simply saying is, it's really hard for one person to understand their own sin, their own shortcomings, their own transgressions, without the Word of God and the Holy Spirit revealing that to them. It's a benefit of the special revelation. Who can discern his errors? Declare me innocent from hidden faults. Keep back your servant also from presumptuous sins. Let them not have dominion over me. Maybe you remember what it was like to be enslaved to sin. Sin habits, the darkness of sin, living in its shadow. We have people in our church that give testimony to the old lifestyle, and they say things like, I can't believe now I used to think those things were fun. That's what I would do, and I would call that fun. But now I'm free. Then I shall be blameless and innocent of great transgression. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock, my redeemer. It is no accident that the very last word of this psalm is the word redeemer, because as we continue down that funnel, we have general revelation, then special revelation, and then as we apply God's word, that special revelation, to our own souls and our own hearts, we understand God has saved me, a sinner, through his son Jesus Christ's death on the cross. And when Jesus Christ died on the cross, he allows me to crucify the old self as well, so that the life I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. You know, it seems like we have to live in a constant dichotomy of existence where we can come to church and we wake up in the morning, we have our devotions, then we go out to the real world or the secular world or the other world, and now we have to have the other foot out there, and we face all these other pressures and these other worldviews and these other temptations and this other marketing that's marketing toward our flesh. But I want to close the psalm with a reminder that you can take these truths and you can admire God's salvation through Jesus Christ as his highest miracle. You can speak the entire world into existence, but the distance between a sinner and a holy God was so great, you could not close that gap just by speaking. He took the action of sending his own son to die on the cross for my sins, for your sins, being raised from the dead. So that as I place my faith in him for forgiveness, he gives me the power to walk in freedom from sin. I still get glimpses of what the old nature Jake Heppner is like. They come out when my kids are bad or when life is disappointing. They come out when I don't want to do something hard. They come out when I'm tired, get cranky. So I have to feed my soul with the Word of God. I have to revel in the miracle that the Holy Spirit is alive and revives my heart with God's Word. So in a moment, we're here. We're going to close the service. Casey's going to come up and close us in a word of prayer. But just want to spend a moment in silence and reflection to remember that God is true. People can attack creation. People can attack God's existence. But when you start to probe around in their belief system, there's no answers there. People can attack the morality of the Bible. They can say, we're misunderstanding, or we're judgmental, or that's good for us, or not for everyone else, or whatever. We can testify that when we live according to God's word, he enlivens our souls. He brings purity and cleanness to our heart in a way that nothing else on this planet can bring cleanness and purity and righteousness. And lastly, when my soul is thirsty, your soul needs conviction, it needs healing, needs companionship from the eternal being. We can meditate and reflect. We can offer our hearts up to God for examination. And he shows us what we need to know to bring freedom from sin in the way we walk. Would you just close your eyes for a moment? Spend about 30 seconds, a minute here, and then Casey's going to come close our time with a word of prayer this morning.
Heavenly Father, you are so great. With something so simple as a mere word, you spoke everything into existence. Lord, you are certainly deserving of our worship. Lord, you sent Jesus Christ to die for our sins. Thank you for that. Thank you for all that you do for us. Lord, I think of the world we live in that is so opposed against you, that looks on your people as foolish people. Yeah, Lord, you are so above everything. Lord, thank you for revealing yourself to us in so many ways. Thank you that you gave us knowledge of who you are, that you reached down and revealed yourself to us. Father, may we take our understanding of you to this world who are confused by who you are, who have believed a lie that you do not exist. Lord, help us be bearers of truth, of your character and who you are. Help us do so with love, the same love you have shown us. Help us to love others. Help us to love those who oppose us, who call us names, who say we're fools. Help us to be the light into the world. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
As a song in response to our message this morning, we can sing, "Jesus, Thank You."
Story of the cross, I cannot comprehend. Agonies of Calvary. You, the perfect
I want to welcome you. If this is your first time visiting here at Brookdale, hope you feel welcomed. If you have any questions about who Brookdale is, what we do, why we do it, please speak to either Pastor when he gets back, myself, or any person you can pull aside. We'd be happy to talk with you. If you have any questions, we'd like to answer them for you. As men come forward for offering, reminder first and foremost that our offering is a time of our worship. If we're not doing it with a worshipful heart, we need to stop, evaluate why we are giving. And as a collection plate is being passed, if you choose to, you can choose to participate this way or online on faithlife.com. By simply clicking a couple buttons, you can make that your worship of God as well. Just a couple announcements today. First of all, the core document refresh is complete, about 99% complete. We need to get your guys' feedback. There should be documentation in the back on everything, on our doctrinal beliefs, in our purpose here at Brookdale. Please look that over. I think there's a planned meeting coming up on May 22nd for your feedback. We already had one session of feedback and it was very valuable and we encourage more. If you have any questions in between time, please see a member of the team, myself, Pastor Overmiller, Reed Roysom, and DJ Finkel, and Mark Hulbert, if you have any questions. Otherwise, please plan on attending the feedback session, and we'll get this feedback is valuable to us. But this whole project is bigger. It was bigger than we anticipated, but it was really, really encouraging as we worked through it. So please plan on that. Vacation Bible School is coming up here in a couple short weeks. Printed invitations are now available in back, and Caleb's going to speak a little bit more to that here in a second. If you have not registered, and this is important, if you have not registered your kid to attend, you can do so online by on faithlife.com as well. Or it's not too late. I think Becky may still be looking for volunteers. Speak with her if you want to participate and be a blessing to the young people who are coming for the whole week. Caleb?
Good morning. And so, like he said, we got PBS coming up pretty soon, and so I've been working with Pastor Thomas, and we have made canvassing maps to go and get the word out. So if you look, and once you go out to the foyer towards the bookstore, against the wall there's a table, and there I have maps along with different, along with the cards, and I have it set up so if you guys want to go out, you sign out and you like write which map you take, and then so you'll cross out the houses you did, then you'll return it so that we know which ones have been hit so that we don't go back to those ones. And so we are trying to get the word out, and that would help us a lot if we could get people to volunteer. And you can do this at any time that suits your schedule. In the upcoming weeks, there's going to be a canvassing Sunday where we, following the service, will go out and try to do it as a big group. And so if you have any questions, you can speak to myself or to Pastor Thomas when he gets back, and it'll just be a great way for us to try to get the word out to the neighborhood.
There's a new Sunday school series going to be beginning. I mentioned a little bit this morning. On May 29th, Pastor's going to begin a new series on doctrines, specifically entitled Living in the Real. So it's taking our doctrinal beliefs, who we believe or what we believe and why we believe it, and applying that to real life scenarios that we encounter each and every day. So it's putting our faith into practice and being able to solve issues we face based on what we believe. So it looks like encouraging lesson time. So we encourage you guys to participate in that as well. And then finally, next Sunday is Baptism and Membership Sunday. It's going to be another exciting time of baptism. I think we have three baptisms planned. If it's not too late, if you want to participate, if you feel God is leading you in the area of baptism, please talk to Pastor or myself, and we will get you going. We want to celebrate these decisions people are making, and we're going to do so afterwards, or during the baptism, but also afterwards with the fellowship meal. All are invited, whether you're a member here or not. We encourage everyone to come for a potluck meal. Everyone is asked to bring a main dish and a salad or dessert. So main dish, salad, or dessert. And that's all I have for announcements.
Our closing song this morning is our song of the month, so I hope you appreciate some new songs that we've been singing, and I haven't gotten to the point where I start singing them without the words, but driving down the road. So please join us with I Will Wait For You, Psalm 130.
I will wait for you. trust in him today. Find healing in his sacrifice. I will wait for you. I will wait for you through the storm and through the night. I will wait for you, surely wait for you, for your love is my delight.
Day, enjoy the sunshine. You are dismissed.